Technically, yes. All right. So let's resume. It is my pleasure to introduce our second speaker for this morning, Didier Pilau. He is from Universidade Federal do Rio de Janeiro, and he will be talking about asymptotic stability of Zakharov-Kuznetsov solitons in dimension 2. Didier, please.
Okay, thank you very much, Diego and Ricardo, for the invitation. I'm very, very pleased to be here. And so this work is based on a joint, sorry, this talk is based on a joint work with Raphaël Cotte, which is at Ecole Polytechnique, Claudio Munoz, which is at Universidade do Chile, and Gidon Simpson at Drexel University. Okay, so the Zakharov-Kuznetsov equation, maybe I will write it on the board, is this equation. So it's a nonlinear dispersive equation, dtu plus dx1 Laplacian of u plus u squared is equal to zero. So it's an evolution equation. There is a dispersive part in the linear part of the equation, so here. And there is a nonlinear part, u squared. Here u is a real value function, and x is in Rd. So we will decompose x in x1, which always be in R, and x2 in Rd minus 1. So x is a space, and t is a time variable. And here, delta is the Laplacian, so you have the x1 component and then the Laplacian in x2. Okay. Of course, in the case of d equal to 1, so there is no x2 component, we have the well-known KdV Kotov-Vec de Vries equation, which is one of the most famous nonlinear dispersive equations. And so you can see this equation as a d-dimensional generalization of KdV. Okay. So it was introduced by those guys, Zakharov and Kuznetsov, to describe the propagation of ionic acoustic waves in uniformly magnetized plasma, and physically, so in 2 and 3D cases. Of course, you can then mathematically generalize to D dimension, but we'll mainly focus on those two cases, the physical cases. Rigorously, you can derive it from the Euler-Poisson system. It was done by Lan, Linares, and So recently with a magnetic field. So here it is, if you want, you need to take, this is a big system, and you take an asymptotic regime. So it is as for the KdV equation, it is derived as an asymptotic regime of a more general system or equation. And also, Daniel Anquan derived it from the Vlasov-Poisson system, which is still bigger than the Euler-Poisson. And then you need to take a combined regime of Coldion and also long wave limits. Okay. But what we will, for our purpose, so it is a physical model, asymptotic model, and rigorously, it makes sense if you derive it to a more general system. Of course, we will focus on this equation. So here there are conserved quantities. I think it doesn't appear here, but here what I did that I put instead of the quadratic nonlinearity, I put a UP in the nonlinearity. So it is the generalized ZK equation. And we have at least three conserved quantities. So the integral of U, the L2 norm, and also an Hamiltonian. Those equations are Hamiltonian. So it is at the H1 level here. Okay, here it is 1/2 of the gradient to the square minus UP plus 1, if you want. You also have a scaling invariance. So if you take a solution of the generalized Zakharov-Kuznetsov equation and you rescale U lambda this way, here lambda is a positive constant, U lambda will also be a solution of the equation. And in particular, if you want to compute the H dot S norm, so you put a S derivative in L2, you see that you have this 2 over P minus 1. You derive S time, so plus S, And here you have L2 base in D dimension, U minus D over 2, of U naught in H dot S. So U naught is the initial data. So the data in T is equal to 0. In particular, you can find the critical indice here, so for which the H dot S norm is preserved. It's a small computation, but you can find that SC is equal to D over 2 minus 2 over P minus 2. No, it's the same scale because here you have actually three derivatives in both. So here you can rewrite this dx1 cube u plus dx1 dx2 to the square u. So you have each time three derivatives in the. So, for example, if you look to the criticality in L2, when S is equal to 0, a small computation, you find that P, okay, so here, I wrote it, but it, maybe it's not clear, but I'm looking at the generalized equation, so I put a P here, okay, instead. And you find that P is equal to 1 plus 4 over D. And if you look at the H1 critical, which is the energy critical, you find that in dimension 1 and 2, it's all the P, and in dimension greater or equal than 3, it's 1 plus 4 over D minus 2. Okay, so for the one who are familiar, it's exactly the same as for the nonlinear Schrödinger equation, for example. In our case, so we will be interested in the physical case, so the quadratic nonlinearity. The SC is D over 2 minus 2, and in particular, it is L2 subcritical in dimension 1 for KdV, and 2 and 3, which are the physical dimension. So basically, we can think that we are in a L2 subcritical regularity. Okay. So I will recall briefly the well-posedness for this equation. So for us, the important result is one of Faminsky in 95. That ZK is locally and then globally well-posed in the energy space, H1. Globally, because you have the conservation law. So if you are locally well-posed, you are at the L2 subcritical regularity. Then you can use them and you are globally well-posed. It was then improved by Felipe Linares and Ademir Pastor. So they were able to enlarge a little bit the resolution space. So HS S greater than 2 over 4. And very recently, there are two independent work, one of Grönrock and Herr, and one of myself with Luc Molinet. And we are able to enlarge the space up to HS for S greater than 1 over 2. But for our purpose here, we will the Faminsky result is enough. We are globally well posed in the energy space. This is in dimension 2. In dimension 3, things are a little bit more complicated. So there is this result of Linares and So. HS S a little bit greater than 1. It was improved recently by Francis Ribot and Stéphane Vanto, but it's still S larger than 1. So we are not in H1, so the solution is still local. And then with Luc, we were able to extend that to globally well-posed, but still for S greater than 1 by using a Brésis-Galouet type argument. So it's still an open problem. If you want, I think this would be an interesting open problem to get the local well-posedness in the energy space in three dimensions. So this is not so easy. And that's why in our case, we would restrict to the, that's one of the reasons we would restrict to the R2 case, because we are globally well-posed in H1. Okay, so this is for the well-posedness. So the problem is well-posed, and what we would like to do is to understand a little bit the dynamics of this equation, okay? And so when you want to understand the dynamic of the equation, first you try to look at some special solution. And so here we will look at traveling wave solution, so solution of this form, they will travel in the x1 direction because the x1 direction is the direction of propagation. Okay, so if you want this equation is like KdV in the x1 direction, and in the x2 direction is like a Schrödinger. Okay, but the direction of propagation is this one. So you look at a solution on the form Q of x1 minus Ct x2. with a Q going to zero at infinity. So you plug that in the equation, and you find that Q must be solution to the following elliptic equation, so which is actually a very famous elliptic equation because it is exactly the same when you look at the standing wave for the nonlinear Schrodinger equation. So the elliptic equation is this one, minus Laplacian of Q plus Q or CQ. Here I can put C is equal to 1. Minus 2 squared is equal to 0. Okay, so of course it has been extensively studied. It is known that, so in this energy subcritical case, so it is in our case, there exist positive radial solutions. So, for example, the worst of Beresticky and Lyons. And those solutions are unique up to translation, so it is by the uniqueness was proved by Kwong. 89, and this solution, so the positive one, we will call ground state. Of course, if you take, do not assume a positive solution, then there is no uniqueness. Okay, but here we will be interesting. So in the ground state, you know, moreover, that the ground state is smooth and it decays exponentially at infinity. So in particular, we will what we will call solitary waves in our case will be the solution of this form, but when Q is the ground state of the equation. Okay. And you can see, you can wonder, maybe there can be solution in other direction, not only in the X1 direction, but it is not, at least not in the energy space, not in H1. This will prove that by using Poincaré identities. So really, the only direction of propagation of those solitary waves is in X1 direction. So if you want to understand what happened around those solutions, you need to understand a little bit of the linearized operator around the solution Q. So let me write it in the case C is equal to 1. L is a linearized operator around this equation, so minus Laplacian plus 1 minus 2. So of course, it is also very well studied because it is the same as for the nonlinear Schrodinger equation. So, okay, by scaling, you can always assume that C is equal to 1. And in the energy subcritical case, you know that it is a nice self-adjoint operator. The spectrum, the essential spectrum is 1 plus infinity. You also have 0 is also an eigenvalue. Okay, so if you want to make a small design, you have the essential spectrum here, 1 plus infinity. 0 is an eigenvalue. In the kernel of L, you have it is spanned by the gradient of Q, so it is d-dimensional if you are in dimension d. And then you also have a negative eigenvalue that I will call minus lambda naught. Okay. And it is the unique negative eigenvalue. So we have one negative eigenvalue and also zero, which is an eigenvalue. Another guy which will be useful for us. So if you consider the derivative of QC with respect to the scaling, okay, so d over dc of qc in c is equal to 1, we will call this guy lambda q. And then we have that if you differentiate this equation with respect to c, you see easily that L of lambda q is equal to minus q. So this will be important for us. It is L of lambda q is equal to minus q. Okay, so this is well understood. For example, you can see the work of Weinstein in the 80s. Moreover, you know that if you compute the scalar product of Q and lambda Q, this is always positive in the subcritical case. So this is a small computation, and for us it will be important here. Okay. So what do we know about those spatial solutions? We know since the work of Anne de Boire in 96 that they are orbitally stable in the energy space. So what does it mean orbitally stable? That if you begin, you take an initial value close to the ground state in H1, the energy space, you will remain closed for all time. Okay, so here I have not see for all time. So this is really important. The stability result is a result for all time, and since you take all time, you can begin with a small soliton which will travel to a velocity a little bit different, and then after a long time, the two will be far. Okay, so if you want to have a stability result, you need to take actually the orbit, so you need to take the infimum over all the translation. Okay, so you are close up to the translation if you want. So you are close to the orbit, so you call that orbital stability. Okay. This was proved by Andebois. And so what we would like to do is to understand better what happens when you begin close to a ground state, okay, a special solution. And our main result is the following. So maybe I can write it on the board. Okay, so this is our main result, that actually you are asymptotically stable in the energy space. So in our case, as I say, we take the Zakharov-Kuznetsov equation, so P is equal to 2, and also in dimension 2. Okay. And if you take, you fix some velocity for the ground state, then for all beta positive, there exists a very small epsilon not positive, such that if you take an initial data close to this soliton, this ground state, sorry, in H1, then you will actually, the emanating solution U will converge to a ground state which is very close to this one. So there is a C plus close to C0. Okay. And also a translation, so rho is equal, here I'm in dimension 2, so rho 1, rho 2, which is a C1 function of R in R2, such that I will converge, so U of T, so U is the emanating solution of U naught, we know that it is globally well posed, I will converge to QC plus minus the translation. Okay. Locally in H1, locally on the right, so for X1 greater than beta T. Okay. This is it. And also the translation will converge to the derivative of the translation will converge exactly to the velocity of this guy. Okay. Rho 2 prime of T tends to 0. Okay, so this is our main result. And really, it describes completely the solution close to the solitary wave. So I think it is an interesting result. If you want to understand the dynamic of the solution, first you need to understand close to the special solution. Okay, so I would like to make a few remarks. First, if you look to a plane wave solution, so solution of this form of the linear equation, so you drop actually the nonlinearity of the linear equation, you see that W must satisfy the kind of relation with K1 and K2. So it is exactly this relation. Then you can compute the group velocity. You find that the gradient of W is something like that. And in particular, you observe that the first coordinate is always negative. And the second one, you have an angle of coordinate greater than p over 3. So if I make a drawing, so here we are in the phase space. So maybe I will erase here. You have something like that. So So you are in the phase pairs. You have something like that. So you know that the solitons are traveling to the right. So here they are point in the phase pairs, but they are in this direction, and the dispersion is going like that. So in this direction, and here the you have an angle p over 3. Okay, so really the direction of propagation of the soliton and of the dispersion is completely one is going to the right and the other one to the left. And this is important. Okay, so this is dispersion. This is important because it is not the case, for example, for the nonlinear Schrödinger equation or for other two D models, for example. And in those cases, the asymptotic stability is still a very hard open problem. Okay, so here, in this case, we have this nice property of separation of the dispersion and of the soliton. Another observation that the convergence here in our theorem cannot be better than that. Actually, it cannot hold in the whole space H1 because you have conservation of the mass and the energy. And you have a variational characterization of the soliton, which minimizes the energy at a constant L2 norm, if you want. So you need to have a loss. And the loss, it can be due to what? To a smaller soliton, so which travel at a slower velocity, or dispersion, which is going on the left. So you need to take that in account in your convergence. One way to do that is to put weight on the space, but here actually we are doing a sharper analyze and we put actually a local H1 norm. Okay. That's exactly the reason where this H1, X1 greater than beta t. Another observation that actually we can, instead of to have the convergence for X1 greater than beta t, we can change a little bit here the half space. And we can make a rotation here of theta up to p over 3. Okay, so I will, if I have time, I will explain a little bit why. And this certainly may be linked to this pi over 3 here. Okay, so it with the dispersion. Okay, so I will briefly recall what are the known results for asymptotic stability in one dimension. So if you take the KdV equation. The first result is due to Pego and Weinstein in 94. So here they are putting a strong decay, so weight on the initial data. Then there is this seminal work of Martel and Merle. They are doing it in the energy space, so in the spirit. And it was improved by Merle and Vega in L2. Martel and Merle revisited the result, so with this local convergence in H1. And finally, they were able to do that for general nonlinearity, if you perturb a little bit the U-square here. Also, for example, this work of Mitsumachi and Setkov, revisiting the Pego-Weinstein in L2. This technique was adapted for other 1D models, so for example, for Benjamin Ono, by Koenig and Martel, by using the Martel-Merle technique. And for BBM, also by using the Martel-Merle technique. And very recently, I think an interesting word for the Gross-Pitayevsky equation. So it is a nonlinear Schrödinger equation, but with solution going to 1 at infinity. And they were able to do that, but still in one dimension. Okay. So here, what will we do is we adapt the approach of Martel-Merle to the dimension 2. And so I will try to explain this better, but there are two main ingredients in the proof. The first one is a rigidity result, so we classify all the L2 compact solution around the soliton. This is based on a varial identity, and then we also have monotonicity formula for part of the L2 norm and the energy. Okay, so there are the two main ingredients in the proof, and as far as we know, it is the first asymptotic stability result for a nonlinear dispersive model in dimension 2, if you don't make very non-standard assumption on the spectrum of the linearized operator. Okay, so okay, so I will begin with to explain the rigidity result. So rigidity result, if you want, is a kind of a classification of a solution around the ground state, and it's really the equivalent of the Liouville theorem for elliptic PDE. Okay. So here I will begin to explain. I think it's easier to explain in the linear case. So I will assume that P is equal to D is equal to 2, and eta is a solution, so a global solution in H1, of the linearized equation. Recall that L is a linearized operator around the ground state. Okay, so you take a solution of the linearized equation, and you will assume that it decays exponentially around zero, but here it is a linearized operator, so zero is where is the ground state, if you want. So it decays exponentially in x1, but it is uniform in x2, in some sense. Then you need to be in the kernel of L. Okay. So if you observe carefully, this actually is a trivial solution of this equation, because if you are in the kernel of L, you are zero here, but here you don't depend of t, so you are zero also here. But what we say is that all the solutions that are that decay exponentially in x1 are on this form. Okay, so it is a classification result, if you want. And you can relax the second assumption and ask actually that you are the mass is localized close to zero. Okay, so it is really small if you take a strip, a big strip, you know, outside of if you take outside of the strip x1 greater than 1. Okay. So to prove that, we also follow the ideas of Martel-Merle. And the idea is to consider a dual problem. So we will call V is equal to L of eta minus some alpha naught Q. The idea is the following, that dTV, if you do the computation, is exactly L dx1V. So if I recall quickly, we had that eta so eta was this equation, so dx1 L eta. So if we consider a dual problem, what do we do? That actually we can exchange the dx1 L with L dx1. This will be important for us. Also, if you define V like that, you know that it will be orthogonal to the gradient of Q. And also, we have this nice orthogonality property. So this will be very important for us, and it is different as in the world of Martel-Merle. Actually, they have one of the main differences that they are in dimension one. So they have explicit form for the soliton, so they can use other orthogonality conditions here, but we cannot do that because we have one more dimension. And when we use weight function, it cannot depend on the other dimension. Actually, I will try to explain that better. So we need to introduce this condition, which is new here. And you can verify that if you derive this scalar product, so you use the equation, you will have L of dx1v. Here, L is a self-adjoint, so you can put it on the other side. You can integrate by parts here. You have a V, and so you know that L of lambda Q is minus Q. So you have V scalar dx1Q, but this is zero exactly because of that. Okay, so this is constant. So if you adapt correctly the alpha naught, you will see that it will be zero on zero, so it will be zero everywhere. Okay, and you can do that in the L2 subcritical case. So another ingredient in the proof is that you have monotonicity, so we'll try to talk about that in a few moments. But you can see that as, for example, the equivalent of regularity, elliptic regularity. So here V is 2 derivative of eta, and V is still in H1, so you are able to win 2 derivatives if you want. And you still have exponential decay, the same exponential decay for V. So to derive the virial identity, you will do that. You will take a function phi, which is a cutoff function. So it is something like that. Okay, so it is in X1, just in X1. Phi is something like that. And here you can introduce a constant R. Okay, minus 1, this is 1. So this is phi A. And you take the primitive of phi, so I will call a small phi. And so this will be something like that. Okay. A. And the same here. Okay. So this is phi A. And here, as I say, we are in the linear cast, so the soliton is here. Okay. So what you are doing, you are actually trying to look at the part of the mass which are here on the right of the soliton minus the part of the mass which are on the left of the soliton, and the point that this has a sign, you know, and this has a sign. And to do that, it's just to derive the equation and to do integration by part. You will have this expression. So this is always positive. This will be small, if I small, is large, sorry. And okay, this is why you take a dual problem, because this is always positive with a minus sign, okay? Phi A, for example, if X1 is positive, phi A is positive here, but dx1q is negative because q is going to zero. And the same thing if x1 is negative. So actually this is non-negative, and the point that this is almost the quadratic form associated to L. So this will have a sign since you are orthogonal to lambda q and the gradient of q. Okay, so let's assume this petrol property for 2 minutes. So what can you see? That you have a sign for this quantity, and then if you integrate this again and use the exponential decay, you can see that V is zero, but V is zero is exactly eta is on the kernel of L. Okay, so you conclude the proof. Okay, so I will say briefly a word on this spectral property. Actually, if you follow the work of Weinstein, you can verify that if you do. You recall that you have only one negative eigenvalue, so you need to verify the condition like that. In 1D, you can do it. In 1D, you can do it because you know who is Q. You have an explicit form, but in dimension greater than one, it's not easy. So we are able to do it numerically, and for example, here it is a computation of the scalar product. In dimension 2, for p is equal to 2, we are negative, so it is okay. Okay. But in dimension 3, for example, p is equal to 2, we are positive. So this condition is not satisfied, and this is another barrier to get the result in 3D. Okay. But here we are able to do that. Okay, and so we get our Liouville theorem also in the nonlinear case. So I will just enunciate the theorem. If you take a solution which is close to the soliton and which decays exponentially close to the soliton in X1, then you need to be a soliton, at least for the C1, very close to C0. Okay. The proof is exactly the same that in the linear case, so I won't say a word, you know, it's exactly the same proof, but what you will recall that you have classified all the solution around the nonlinear flow of ZK. Sorry, around the ground state for the nonlinear flow of ZK. So if you are L2 compact in X1 and you are close to the soliton, you need to be a soliton. Okay. So we will use this result. I still have 5 minutes. Okay, so I try to explain quickly how to prove this theorem, at least the ideas. You will assume that C0, for example, by scaling is 1, and you take an initial data close to Q. Okay. If you use Anne de Boer stability result, you know that you will be, for all time, close to the soliton. Okay. So in particular, you are bounded in H1. Then you can extract a subsequence which converge weakly in H1 to some limit elements that I will call U infinity. Weakly, and so you will consider the solution U tilde evolving from this limit element U infinity. And so we will prove two things. First, that actually you have the convergence strongly on the right in H1. and also that U tilde satisfies, so it's always close to the soliton. This is okay by weak convergence, but also it satisfies those nice decay assumptions in both sense. So then you can use your Liouville property since you classify all the solution. This is a typo. U infinity must be equal to QC, so to a soliton for C1 close to 1, and you're done. Okay? So I will try to give very briefly an idea on those proofs. So how do you do that? You will use monotonicity formula. Okay? So this time, I'll just do this drawing and I'm done. This time, you're not, this is something like that. So you will compute a part of the L2 mass, but you are like that. Okay, so I should say with, first I should say with this psi m, it's some function like that. Okay, so this is one, and this is one half. So this is my psi m, x1. And what I'm interested in is the following. So here, I'm in a y naught. Here it is a t, so it is a tx, so t naught. I'm here. So when t is equal to t naught, x1 tilde is equal to rho 1, so here it is rho 1 of t naught. And if you recall, the soliton, it evolves at a velocity rho 1, which is almost 1. Okay, so it is like that. So here it is rho 1 of t, if you want. Here you are at t. Okay, so the soliton is here. It is here. But here, where do you put your weight? You put your weight in a velocity 1 half of t, if you want. So you put your weight here. Here you have rho 1 of t minus 1 of t naught, sorry, minus 1 half of t, minus 1 of t naught minus t. So actually, you will put here, you have the soliton. Okay, here you have the soliton. And you will put your weight here, if you want. Okay? So you will compute the part of the mass on the right of the soliton. And you will say that, you will see that it cannot increase. Okay, if y naught is very large, it is very, very small. So this is linked to the fact that you can expel mass on the left of the soliton as dispersion of soliton, but on the right, it cannot increase. So if you use that, two minutes?
Sure,
yes. So if you use that, for example, you can use that between t0 and t naught, you can see that this limit sup of u square is very small, and at the limit you can have the exponential decay for u on the right. So another thing that you can deduce with this formula is that if you take y naught very large, you will be very small. So on the right. So for example, if I look at the x1 direction. This is the last things I would like to explain. Here I am a minus a, for example, for an arbitrary a, zero. So here, if I took a big r here, I will be smaller. Okay? Here I will be small. So in 1D, what can you do? Since you are converging weakly in H1, you will converge strongly on a compact. Okay, to a solution. So you are really the strong convergence of the right, and you are done. But what is the problem? That here we have another dimension. We are in R2. So if you want to do that, you cannot do it anymore because you have a strip, and of course it is not compact. So what can you do to? So of course this is not a problem in the Merle-Martel for KdV, but for us it is a problem. So what can you do? You can actually derive monotonicity formula, but on a small cone, if you want, around the x1 direction. And then you will be small here, and in the triangle, it is still compact, so you can run the argument. Okay, so I think I will stop here. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Didier, for the nice talk. Is there any questions or comments?